long before they start making vampire movies about you two. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the irreverent, sardonic, and yet, at the same time, the matter-of-fact voice of someone that we have known for a brief period of time, but have come to love. Mohammad Hanif, author, playwright, filmmaker, and journalist. Now, before we start talking about actual texts, and he's threatening to fall asleep on me, so we are giving him huge doses of coffee, and I promise you I'll try and pinch him awake if he does.
Maybe something more strong?
Not right now, not before lunch anyway. Honey, if you're on record as having said, a fiction writer has no social responsibility. And yet your first book mocks a dictator. Second book empathizes with a Christian woman. Sounds suspiciously like a socially relevant statement that you're making. What do you have to say about that?
Thank you. Can I call you Nivi?
Yes, please.
This is the most exciting moment in my life. Then I can call my young boy's crush, but like her nickname. Lovely. Naveed is lovely. And your question was, I mean, sometimes, like, writers are not supposed to kind of talk beyond their books. And sometimes they're asked stuff. And they kind of say stupid things. So I do believe that writers' basic responsibility is to the page. Like, that if it works on the page, then you're a writer. But surely, I don't think mocking a dictator is social responsibility. I think it's just fun. Like, we do it for fun, some kind of, you know, dead guy who everyone evokes. And I've been a journalist, and I don't know any single journalist in Pakistan who can write, like, a 900-word piece without mentioning Ziaul Haq's name. So that's So I kind of grew up with that. I think as a journalist, you have a social responsibility, and journalists mostly don't realize that. They think that they are kind of gods and they don't have any responsibility. But I would go back and say that yes, when you're creating characters, when you're writing fiction, your basic responsibility is to your plot, to your paragraph, to your sentence, to your character, whether that works on the page or not. But as a citizen, and especially as a journalist, of course you have huge, huge responsibilities.
So how do you manage to balance the two Hanifs, the fiction writer and the journalist?
I kind of run away from one Hanif and end up with the other. Usually when I'm kind of doing journalism, and sometimes journalism can become too much in Pakistan. So you think, okay, I'll just stop and go and sit in a corner and try and create a story. But and the strange thing is that sometimes stories can become too much as well, because your characters aren't doing anything. You're sitting day after day after day on your desk, and nothing is happening. So you want to run away from your own creations as well, and then you go back to real life and do some reporting or write a rant. So it kind of works quite well.
One gives release to the other, in a sense.
I mean, that is the idea. It usually doesn't happen. They're both torture, basically.
Well, for someone who says that the art of writing fiction is basically being able to put your ass on a chair.
Somebody famous kind of said that, and I just quoted that. But it is true. Like otherwise, somebody like me will kind of, you know, put their ass in a chair and watch TV. Like, but that does not lead to good fiction. But that is the idea. It's like, you know, that you, year after year, day after day, week after week, it's a solitary kind of exercise that you.
Well, I think that speaks for all creative acts. I think the art of
no, there are like other kind of forms of art. Theater is there, and people kind of collaborate. You always are in each other's face, and you always kind of, you know, work, have to work with other people, have to work with other people, have to work with other people. Similarly, kind of, you know, sort
no,
of.
No, I wasn't thinking of performance. I was thinking more of poetry or painting or
yeah.
creating music. Now, these are solitary arts.
Yes.
Very large.
I can't do any of those things.
Well, join the gang. I can't sing to save my life. However, there's something which has been intriguing me for some time. And I think this is also kind of corollary to what was being discussed in the session being held in this hall earlier about the language that one uses.
Yes.
Now, you confessed rather wryly and ruefully that you know 3.5 languages. And that as a journalist, you had promised yourself that when you were a journalist, you would write a book in English, write a play in Urdu, and make a film in Punjabi.
I mean, really, when I said that, it made complete sense. I don't know. But I was young and stupid then. Yes, I mean, I don't know. Kids these days probably don't realize that we have a strange kind of arrangement for teaching children. I went to a school where, like, you know, at the age of 5, you go to school and your kind of education starts in Urdu. That was in Okara, check number 2x4L. Now, a 5-year-old already has like some education. He knows, like, you know, this is a tree and this is a table and this is mummy and this is daddy, right? But as soon as you go to school, all of that vocabulary is completely redundant because they start teaching you in Urdu. And these are teachers who can't even speak Urdu themselves, but that's what your education system is like. And by the time you kind of do your primary school and you go to high school, there you start to learn like A, B, C, D, you know, that kind of stuff. And by the time you've done your matric and you go to college and you start studying medicine or engineering or whatever, suddenly everything is in Angrezi. And nobody has actually taught you to read Angrezi properly. So you end up like with like this really half-baked education where you cannot really comprehend any of these three languages properly. You speak like Punjabi with your mother, but you don't write in it, don't read in it. You kind of go to this where you kind of, you know, read Urdu, but you kind of actually don't. You spend like, you know, almost like 10 years of your life trying to kind of pretend to speak in Urdu properly. And as soon as you're grown up, you realize that all of that was rubbish. Nobody's going to give you a job if you don't know how to read and write in English. And then you kind of start doing that. So by the time you've gone through these three phases, you're probably hopeless anyway. You can't do any of these things. And I think it's kind of getting a lot worse now. Because you just don't know what language do you kind of belong to, what language.
Well, as an educationist, I'm intrigued by the idea that you move from a place like Okara and you move to the diaspora. Mm. And of course, it's all English there. Mm. And then you come home and you settle in Karachi. Mm. And you choose a language which is not really the language of the people. Mm-hmm. You know, because it is a marginalized language, despite our best efforts. it was very interesting for me. I met Girish Karnal recently. He was here for the Fairs Memorial Lecture. And we got to talking about language with him. He writes in Kannada, which is his mother tongue. The only reason he translates his works, and he does it himself, because he knows exactly what he wants to say, into English is because he wants a wider audience, obviously, because for his plays, etc., he needs to reach out to people. Why didn't you ever think of doing anything like that? I mean, what is the first language?
I have thought and done all of those things. I've written love poems in Punjabi, as you do. For girls, obviously, whatever. I write in Urdu. I kind of make a living, kind of. I do kind of journalism in Urdu. Lots of it. I used to be the BBC Urdu service editor. And I write kind of in English as well. So, and mostly you think that you're failing in all of these three kind of, you know, the love poems don't work, the Urdu rants don't work, novel is kind of not as good as you thought it should be. So
you still think that there's room for improvement in all the work that you've done, in all the noise you've made?
Yes, I think it's like not loud enough. I mean, one needs to kind of shout, you know, sort of louder. I mean, it's like you always kind of, whenever you do something, you think that, oh my God, this is not what I really want to do. Because you taught and you kind of read that when you sit down with an idea in your head, and by the time it goes onto the page, and you said, it sounded much better when it was in my head.
Yes.
On the page, it's kind of, you know, maybe it's working sometimes, but mostly it's kind of disappointing. No? That's how
it's kind of anticlimax.
Yeah,
it sounded so much better when you were thinking about it. But talking about journalism, and I want to quote here, this is a wonderful quotation, because when you said, I haven't made enough noise or not loud enough, truth is not only violated by falsehood, it may be equally outraged by silence. This is Henri Amiel. He's he's a Swiss philosopher and poet, 19th century. Now, I think that that holds true for the noise that you haven't made, which was loud enough, which is with reference to the missing Baloch and the stories that you've tried to tell in what you call your little pamphlet. Do you want to talk about that piece of work?
Yeah, no, it's like one of those basic truths. I've been a journalist for a very long time, and I was taught by one of the greatest editors and teachers who kind of, you know, in Pakistan, Razia Bhatti. She was my mentor and editor, and that's what she taught you, basically, that you need to care about the story, and you need to tell the story that nobody else is willing to tell, because that's what, you know, sort of journalism means. That's what independent journalism means. And the other thing that she taught me was that you need to care about your punctuation, because you cannot be good, and that being brave is not good enough. You know, you need to be kind of very, very good on the page. She would, like, you know, have like 3 a.m. calls, like, you know, वो कॉमा जो है आपने कहीं उस पे गलत उस पे तो नहीं लग गया एंड कम बैक टू द ऑफिस
व्हिच ही वाज अ फेनोमिनल एडिटर
या एंड ही वाज काइंड ऑफ ब्रिलियंट दैट वे दैट यू नीड टू हैव बोथ ऑफ दीस थिंग्स यू नीड टू टेल अ स्टोरी दैट नोबडी एल्स इज विलिंग टू टेल बट यू नीड टू टेल इट वेल यू कांट बी स्लॉपी जस्ट बिकॉज यू थिंक दैट यू आर बीइंग ब्रेव or you're doing something like, you know, doing something that nobody else is doing, but you need to do it well.
So
you need to write it.
The craft.
Well, yeah.
It's
yes,
the craft that
yeah,
she's talking
yeah.
about.
So this is a little book that I've written. It's called The Baloch Who Is Not Missing and Others Who Are. And this is as simple as the fact that there's a story in Pakistan and nobody's willing to cover it for some strange reason. That there are hundreds, if not thousands, of Baloch boys, kids mostly, who are kind of, you know, who've been kidnapped by the state itself, meaning like by our intelligence agencies, by like, you know, ISI and military intelligence and some of people who work with them. And they go missing for a very long time. Yeah. Like in some cases, 10 years. In some cases, like 7 years, 4 years. And many of them are kind of, you know, found on the roadsides, like, you know, shot and badly tortured. And they obviously, these people have families. And their families have been protesting for like 4.5 years now. They were here in Islamabad since, you know, Quetta is far, the Balochistan is far away, nobody apparently can go there. So they come here to you. They come to Lahore, they come to Islamabad, they come to Karachi.
They bring their stories with them.
They have, like, you know, pictures of their, you know, sort of brother, sons, and basically they just want you to hear their stories.
Yeah.
And our media, as independent as it is, refuses to kind of look at them as if, like, you know, this is, does not exist. As these people who sit outside your offices like day after day after day after day, for months, like for 3 months. And nobody kind of wants to talk to them, actually.
Why? What's the reason? I mean, when you see these stories sitting at your doorstep, why would you as a journalist not want to explore these?
A, I think journalists by nature are kind of lazy. B, I think they're scared. It is, as they say, it is a sensitive subject. I don't know, it's sensitive for whom. And third is like a crass commercial reason, because TV channels, why would they care? Because do they get any advertising from Balochistan? No. Do they have like large enough audience from there?
No.
And when you talk to these people, you immediately get into the sense of who are we? What is our relationship with the state? Can kind of state pick up these people and keep them? Is there, like, you know, any kind of law that can stop them? Because I keep wondering, agar aise hi farz kare aap ki Lahore mein aap rehti thi,
ji
400 bachche Lahore se utha ke fauj aapki le jaye aur rakh le apne paas, mera khayal hai hafta bhi nahi rakh sakti, nahi hai itni jo hai Lahori jo hai wo bahut gusse honge, naraz honge fauj se.
Nahi nahi, assi te agga la deyange.
Bilkul. Te, and that is the nature of state. They can do it in Balochistan because they can. They can get away with it. They know that Punjab is not going to be bothered. Karachi is not going to give them any trouble. So they can get away with it. And they keep doing it, you know, sort of year after year, year after year. And they are like, when you talk to them, they're like, ek to Balochistan waisi chota, us middle class aur bhi choti hai. Everybody that I've talked to, either teachers, doctors, students, bright kids, right? And they go missing for doing what? Ke college mein khade hoke takreer kar di ke Baloch hame apne hamare rights hai. And the next day you're gone, and then, and the most frightening thing is that they don't tell you that whether your kid is alive or dead. And that's a deliberate policy. Like for 4 years, 6 years, 8 years, because it, people keep going. There's like a, this is not like all up in the air. There's like whole paper trail, like court rulings, FIRs, like, you know, sort of. So there's whole like mountains of evidence to prove that this boy was picked up by these people. And they won't tell you whether this boy is alive or dead. So like for 4 years, like 6 years, their families are sitting there kind of
in limbo,
trying to believe that he's alive, trying to get them release, but never ever kind of knowing whether this whether our kid is alive or not. And the ones who kind of get lucky and are released, I've talked to some of them, and they won't talk. They say that once in a life is enough. I don't want to be picked up again, because the kind of torture that they give you is like, you know, make you forget what like Punjab police does or anything. It's like it's beyond horrendous. And you are a parent, I'm a parent, and you know what happens. Like, agar aapka bachcha school se aapne usko pick karna hai, you know, let's say kya 1 baje 1:30 baje chutti hoti, and you go there and your kid is not there, what do? Go to the inside the school and say, oh, where's my kid? And they said, oh, your kid left, and your kid, like, you know, doesn't come home. Like, it happens, like, even for half an hour, you kind of, you know, go crazy. I mean, forget kids. Like, you know, sometimes your pet goes missing, you know, or ghar mein khana nahi pakta. So kind of imagine somebody whose son left college, hasn't come home for 5 years, and they've been to kind of, you know, every court, every, you know, sort of media organization, every political party, and they still haven't been able to figure out whether my kid is alive or dead.
On that point, you know, I'd like to add to this. One of the main reasons why I picked this particular topic to start with and go on to Exploding Mangoes and Our Lady of Alice Bhatti later on is because there's a personal history behind this. Two of my brothers, my younger brothers, joined the Balochistan movement and disappeared for 10 years. So I know exactly what you're talking about. And it wasn't until there was a general amnesty that they could come back to Pakistan. By that time, my father had passed away, and it was a horrific time because the whole suspended limbo of whether they were alive or dead, and there were shoot at sight orders for them by the army. So I know exactly what you're talking about. And there is a particularly poignant chapter in this, what you call pamphlet, but it's a golden pamphlet as far as I'm concerned. And for anybody else who reads this, there is a chapter on the marriage of Asghar Ali's son. Asghar Ali is a man who's gone missing. And when his son is about to get married, because obviously life has to go on, and somebody remembers him, his nephew narrates that, and everyone starts to cry. And he says, I had never seen so many people cry for so long. And these are chilling words, because it's happening right now as we speak. And these are things, as Hanif has pointed out very clearly, that there's a media blackout about this, because there's no marketability for that kind of story.
I was kind of stunned. We were having like one of these little launch things in Karachi Arts Council. And obviously some of the families were there, and other people were there, and these women came in from Lehari. They were in burqas, and they had never done a protest before in their lives. And they didn't know whether they could come in or they had to stand outside, because 3 days earlier, her brother, who's a journalist for a Baloch newspaper, he had been kidnapped in Karachi. And these people had, because that's not what you think about. You living a normal life, you don't really think that tomorrow I'll have to wake up, like, you know, have, like, you know, those panflexes of my brother's picture and go and stand somewhere in some kind of hopeless way. It hasn't stopped. My idea was to shame my journalist friends into kind of doing a bit more reporting on this. Some do and some kind of don't. But like watching these, like, you know, four women just barging into Arts Council, not knowing like, how do you start a protest? Because they just, and I was scared that they're just starting today and they have no idea that for how long they will have to keep doing this without kind of, you know, any kind of remote promise of like justice or fairness or any of those things that we kind of usually take for granted, that you know, if we haven't done anything, we'll be fine. We kind of, you know, go home and go to sleep.
Mm. Well, moving on to another subject, I'm very hopeful that because this book is available outside, that the audience here will go out, make an effort, buy this, read it. It's six case studies, and these are all 100% true because they're based on ample research that Hanif has done.
And it's only 130 rupees, so yeah, sure.
I'm sure we can spare that. My question to you is perhaps a little more intimate in the sense that you say love is the first transgression. Sounds very biblical when you say that. What exactly do you mean?
Sounded like a good idea when I wrote it. I don't really know. And since you said it's biblical, yes, I kind of was almost a half the Quran once. So kind of these kind of some of these sacred texts are, they're quite beautiful, and you can, when, especially when you use them out of context. They're like
they have,
they
a
sound like,
impact.
You know, they're kind of quite fun. Yeah, I think. Yeah.
So when we talk about love being a transgression, and we have characters like Alice Bhatti and Teddy Butt to talk about, it's not just a transgression, it's also across cultural and religious divides. And my question to you is, where has Alice Bhatti come from? Who is this creature? Like, who was your muse? I know the Bhatti, perhaps there's an echo from Razia Bhatti. Yeah. But apart from that, there's nothing that Razia has in common with Alice.
Not at all. I want to write a superwoman kind of novel character. Obviously, that didn't work out very well. No, it's like a creation of sick mind. I've never been a nurse in my life. And I've never been a woman either. I don't know. I think it came from sometimes, you probably know this, the stories sometimes come from really strange places that you didn't kind of, you know, think about. So when my mother was very ill in her kind of last days, so I spent like a lot of time with her.
In the hospital.
And so I just remember kind of waking up like at 3 a.m. in the morning or something in the hospital room, like, and a nurse kind of bent over her, kind of doing whatever nurses do, like, you know, sort of just fixing her drip or something. So I was a kind of, you know, sort of young, sort of lusty boy back then, as boys are. But I remember, like, long time after my mother had passed away, that, like, somebody's doing their work. Like, nobody's kind of overlooking them. There's, like, no doctor or anything. Why does anybody need to do, like, their duty at 3 a.m. In the morning? So in the kindness and the devotion and the honesty that I saw in that moment, I think that stayed with me.
The kindness of strangers.
The kindness of, like, you know, somebody who is doing their work.
Their job.
And doing it well at 3 a.m. in the morning when nobody is there to kind of, you know, judge them whether they're doing it well or not. I didn't sort of realize it at that moment. I think it occurred to me, like, you know, 20 years later. At that moment, I just might have thought, oh, my God, you sexy little thing. But... But it didn't, like, you know, then you kind of grow up and you kind of, you know, have a life, and then you get another perspective on things. So I think that's where it started from. So I wanted to kind of get to know this woman 20 years later, and obviously there's no way of kind of finding out who woman is. So you, in your head, you then you sort of spend a lot of time.
You created her.
Yeah, you kind of, you know, imagine her, right? I don't think, and creation is like, you know, Allah karta hai, wo us tarah ki kaam. So I kind of imagine, you just imagine and dream and kind of, you know, think that maybe she will talk to me, basically.
Well, she more than talks to you, she talks to all of us, and with your permission, I'm going to read a little extract from Our Lady of Alice Bhatti, which I found very telling. She tries to maintain a nondescript exterior. She learns the sideways glance instead of looking at people directly. She speaks in practiced, precise sentences so that she's not misunderstood. She chooses her words carefully, and if someone addresses her in Punjabi, she answers in Urdu, because an exchange in her mother tongue might be considered a promise of intimacy. She uses English for medical terms only, because she feels if she uses a word of English in her conversation, she might be considered a bit forward. When she walks with slightly hurried steps, as if she has an important but innocent appointment to keep. She avoids eye contact. She looks slightly over people's heads, as if looking out for somebody who might come into view at any time. She doesn't want anybody to think that she's alone and nobody is coming for her. She sidesteps even when she sees a boy half her age walking towards her. She walks around little puddles when she can easily leap over them. She thinks any act that involves stretching her legs might send the wrong signal. After all, this is not the kind of thing where you can leave your actions to subjective interpretations. She never eats in public. Putting something in your mouth is surely an invitation for someone to shove something horrible down your throat. If you show your hunger, you're obviously asking for something. I found, as a theatre person, I found this vignette absolutely exquisite, because it created for me this woman who has, well, the healing touch, actually created for me in form and 3D the kind of character that I would have liked to play, except that I do not have the dimensions that Alice Bhatti has. What is this fixation with boobs, Hanif?
It has a lot of research went into it. it's a bad line. Let's not. You read very well. I could just sit here and listen to you kind of read anything. You could pick up like a catalog and start reading.
Don't try and get away from my question. What is this fixation?
It's like,
talk to us about it.
There's no. No, I had a kind of, there's a bad kind of metaphor in the book. And that happened because once I had a dog went missing, like a little puppy. And she kind of went missing. So I spent like, 3 weeks going around looking for her. Mm-hmm. And then when you go, and then you kind of start finding out kind of stuff that how do, and it was a stray dog, we kind of, just rescued from somewhere, and she was with us, and then one day she went missing. So I was kind of going all the places where these stray dogs hang out. And generally, we kind of tend to think that has anybody ever asked a dog whether you kind of, whether you want to a sofa and like, sort of your 3 times meal, or do you want to be loved by other dogs? So, and I was kind of sad, and I wanted my kind of little puppy back. But the more dogs I saw living in the street, they seemed to be having much, much more fun. Yes. And they were kind of all loved up, like, you know, completely, kind of, you know, in every street corner, they were at it. So I kind of used to worry about these things. How do we make these decisions? And what was the thing about breasts? No, I don't know. And it came from there, like looking for puppies, and kind of, it went kind of strange direction. Mm. Yeah.
Well, you know, looking at this aspect of Alice Bhatti, and then I read another excerpt where we get the shock tactics that he employs with such deliberate ease. There was not a single day when she didn't see a woman shot or hacked, strangled or suffocated, poisoned or burnt, hanged or buried alive. Suspicious husband, brother protecting his honor, father protecting his honor, son protecting his honor, jilted lover avenging his honor, feuding farmers settling their water disputes, money lenders collecting their interest. Most of life's arguments, it seemed, got settled by doing various things to a woman's body. This was really not only a shock tactic that worked immensely
it
well.
It is not. I mean, that is the thing that you consider something shocking. Which, if you, and I promise you should try this too. And this happened to me one day. Like, you know, you pick up a newspaper and you go to the city pages, and like you will not find, at least in Karachi city pages, there's not a single day when you will not pick up a paper and we'll see, like, it can be like, you know, sort of some elaborate story. It could be like a 3-inch, 1-column story that when a woman is not killed, right?
True.
And I kind of did this as a kind of one of those sick habits, because baaz dafa ye hota hai ki akhbar nahi aata na Eid pe ya kabhi usme 2 din ka naga hota. And then you kind of pick up the third day and you kind of go, okay, who's killed? And there would be like 3 women, because they, just because newspaper wasn't coming out, that thing didn't stop. So, and these are the things which are reported. So there's nothing shocking about it. It's complete kind of, you know, your bottom line reality that you don't even have to go anywhere and ask. You just have to pick up your own newspaper and just go through it. Okay, where was the woman killed today? Just, you can try it, like, you know, yourself, and you will find one every day. It'll be lucky day when, you know, the newspaper doesn't have that story. It's not just about Karachi, I'm sure, kind of, you know.
Not about Karachi. Mm-hmm. It's about the entire subcontinent, for that matter. Mm-hmm. We've had these horrific incidents just across the border. Mm-hmm. No, by shock, I meant there are so many things that we know. There are so many things that we unconsciously assimilate. And yet there are times in our lives when suddenly we are faced with something we know and it comes home to us with a huge impact. That's what I meant. When you read this passage and you have Alice Bhatti commenting on the fact that it is a woman's body that is the terrain over which she has no control, and there is this huge male world out there which feels that it can do to it whatever it wants with total impunity. Barring, of course, I mean, at the same time, you have this immensely arresting, I would call it that, arresting sense of humor about, where I talked about boobs, and if I'm not going to shock anybody in the audience, you also talk about pubic hair and the length which should be basmati rice or whatever. You know, I don't know where you get these ideas from.
I've read my hadith books, you haven't, so.
talk about exploring a woman's body. Look at him.
Hadith hai bhai, maine kahan se udhe the na. You should, aapne literature zyada padha hai, maine thodi si mazhabi kitabein zyada padhi hain, yes, that's the difference.
Touché. Well said. No, coming back to the more, I think the more matter-of-fact manner in which you tell this incredible story, and it's so layered, despite the fact that, you know, it's like you talking about, or like Alice talks to her communist lover and says, you know, like she's got the flu, she says, I'm pregnant. She says it with the same kind of equanimity. No, what concerns me is all these issues about the religious differences, about being a second-class citizen, about being a woman in a country like Pakistan. And you wrap all these up in this wonderful story of this marvelous creature called Alice Bhatti. You know, to me, very often, when I say Mohammad Hanif, people say, oh, exploding mangoes. But I'm hoping very much that it's going to be, oh, Alice Bhatti from now on, because it may not have got the same kind of response as exploding mangoes did, because there was an immediacy to it. Everybody wanted an answer to that plane that exploded in the air and so on. And you gave them a pretty good run for their money. Being one of the plotters, but of course, somebody else beat you to it. Despite the fact that I personally think, and I think a lot of readers feel that way, Exploding Mangoes is a far more tightly structured narrative. And Alice Bhatti is more of a kind of lumbering, shambling, moving around. It's almost like Alice Bhatti herself, and about the city of Karachi. And with your permission, I'm going to read something that Hanif wrote in 1989, which in a way is prophetic about what Karachi is like today, and where Teddy Butt comes and proposes to Alice Bhatti while she's holding a steaming pan of urine, and he's putting a gun to her head and saying, I'm not looking at those jugs of milk, I'm looking at your eyes. And that's how he proposes to her. Yeah. There's a kind of...
Yes, some of my friends were very romantic. Yeah, that was their idea of romance.
But there's a kind of madness to all this. It's a kind of Monty Python kind of novel, you know, where all the strange things happen. But I would like to read this just to share with the audience about how your concern with the city of Karachi, the violence, the subterranean living that goes on, was very much there in 1989. He still remembers with stark clarity the events of that blood-stained night. Leading a mob of about 20 people, he had set out to avenge the brutal massacre in Kasba Colony. Even 2.5 years after it happened, he can recall vividly every detail of that night which changed his life. We knew which community had done it. Nobody felt the need to know anything else. We were out to get anything remotely resembling a stereotype of that race. They didn't have to go far. A man was asleep outside his shop. By the time he woke up, we had set his shop on fire. Within a few minutes, he was lying on the ground, naked and bleeding all over. He pleaded his innocence. In vain. Nobody among us had any doubt about his innocence. Someone shouted, "Oi!" On that pitch dark night, it sounded like an ancient war cry. Someone picked up a heavy stone and crushed the head of the man who was still shouting for mercy. He died like a cockroach. That's the kind of writing that Hanif has been doing as a journalist. And there's so much more where all that comes from, because when I was trying to look up all that he's been doing and his play, What Now, Now That We Are Dead, and so on, all that continues to happen, and we're very hopeful that this is just the beginning of an absolutely wonderful journey. There will be many more Alice Bhattis out there and many more Teddy Butts and many more Shigris. I hope not. but this brings me to the end of my conversation with Hanif. It's been such a joy. And I would like to now throw the discussion open to the forum. If there are any questions, I'm sure Hanif would be very happy to answer them. Ah, we've stunned you into silence, have we? Yes, we have a question there. Please. And then the gentleman at the back.
Thank you. It was wonderful. Brilliant as always, Mohammad Hanif. On Balochistan, I heard you in Karachi as well. I have read the six case studies. I'd like to know what the response has been. I mean, it's very clear it's out there now. You had public discussions. You mentioned in Karachi the media didn't pick it up. It didn't even listen to that. It still hasn't picked it up. Has there been any response? I mean, has civil society responded? Has there been something from the government? So it's been out there for a little while now. What's been the response? Does it matter that you wrote it?
There's been kind of response that people say, oh, like, you know, heartbreaking, good writing. And that's kind of sad because I've been doing like some sessions with the families, kind of, you know, especially with a boy called Zakir Majid, who was picked up 4 years ago, and her sister Farzana, who's like an MSc student. In the last 4 years, she's been basically like a professional protester. That's all she does. And she's very articulate, very kind of, you know, spot on, very passionate. So sometimes she comes to like events like this and speaks with me. And when I go back home, I say to myself, what does it mean? Like, you know, she wants her brother back. All she's getting is like, you know, sort of an invitation to a literature festival. That is not kind of, you know, that's not how it should be. There have been response, people kind of say that, oh, this is too disturbing. I can't bear to read this. I can't kind of sit through this. To some people, I think some kids are making kind of documentaries about it.
Yeah.
And I know that some reporters kind of, you know, call me up and say, ki uska number de de, mujhe baat karni hai, ye story karni hai. Now they've kind of this new thing they've started, that they've started dumping them in Karachi. So some people kind of, you know, sort of are a bit more kind of proactive covering that. But I'm basically kind of a cynic, so I don't know if it has made any difference. But I hope that somebody will kind of, you know, read it and do more, because there are thousands of stories there, and those should be reported. It's like basic, your basic journalism 101. It's not like, you know, something that...
There was a question back there from that gentleman in black.
So while talking about your own educational background in Okara and all, interestingly, you were referring to yourself in second person. And I sort of felt a bit of detached.
I was?
You were referring to yourself in second person.
In the second
person. And like you were saying, you do this. And in fact, it was, I thought it was
biographic. Oh, yeah. I was doing that. I hate people who do that.
Sorry for pointing you out on this, but I felt, I mean, the question is, do you think this sort of a detachment as far as your writing is concerned as a craft, I mean, is it necessary, like, in terms of your journalism maybe, and maybe in terms of your fictional writing? Because you say that it's for fun. Otherwise, I mean, you know, if you're not detached from it, if you're really emotionally involved, I believe you would go crazy. So, I mean, is it necessary as far as your writing goes?
I mean, who says that I'm not crazy? It's like... It is like one of those really good, profound questions for which I really have no answer.
Yeah.
So I'll just be kind of pretending that if you were like that, then maybe you would become that. But I really have no idea. There are days when you're detached, and then there are days when you try to become detached, and then there are days when you just are not. I really wouldn't know how to kind of answer this. But it is like, this is something that I should think about, and you should think about too. That's that.
We have Madiha there. Mm. Madiha, go ahead, and then we'll come to you.
Since you're so very passionate about your mother tongue, which is Punjabi, and rightly so, have you ever thought of that it's time now that you've established yourself as an internationally as a writer of claim, that you should actually write something, a novel in Punjabi, and then maybe translate it yourself.
Mera khayal hai agar kisi ko to main drama likh sakna Punjabi se novel likhna.
Nahi novel nahi drama the likho lekin a novel likhne the ki problem ki masla.
I think there's a basic problem. I think I have an answer for this because you kind of do what you've kind of, you know, what you've read. I mean, books come from other books. So it's very difficult for me to write a play in English, for example, because wo jali lagta hai ki Pakistani character stage pe khade hue angrezi mein baat kar rahe. I've tried it once or twice, and kind of it doesn't, usme maza nahi aata.
Yes, what now yeah, that we are dead?
Yeah, no, wo pehle wo tha, Urdu ka drama tha, uska naam tha, Marne Ke Baad Kya Hoga, Maut Ka Manzar, badi mashhoor kitab thi, aap logon ko padhni chahiye, Maut Ka Manzar, Marne Ke Baad Kya Hoga. Uske baad uska sequel bhi tha, Jannat Ka Manzar, which is the sexiest book ever written. You guys should check that out. So wo usse inspired hoke maine likha tha, and then since I'm kind of lazy, so I kind of keep recycling the same thing. So baad mein maine usko angrezi mein kar diya tha. But you might have seen kids who kind of do have these rock bands in Pakistan, right? Because they grew up kind of listening to that kind of music. And that's how their mind is kind of, it might even be singing in Urdu, but unki tune, sari sensibility jo hai, wahan se aati hai. The novel, chunke maine Urdu ke bhi padhe hai, but most of the fiction that you read happens to be in English, chahe wo Arabi ho, Spanish ho, Russian ho, because you read it in translation. So wo angrezi mein padha hai. So your kind of head is kind of full of those
the great Russians, Tolstoy, Dostoevsky, at that period, it was mostly Western literature which was influencing modern
this should be compulsory reading in schools.
I think it's more difficult probably to get that back into that idiom, but I think it will be making a very strong political statement if you do that, and I think you should really think of it.
Thank you.
We'll come to you. Ye Bibi ko pehle dijiye.
This is just a comment. I've loved the books that you've written, but I don't mean to generalize, but when I read South Asian authors, it seems like an English commentary going on in characters that they could sort of sympathize with, not most of them, just a small percentage. But when I read your books, I feel you have such a good command over Urdu and other languages that are spoken in Pakistan. And yet, I've written, obviously read you in English, that I feel that it's easier to empathize or relate to your characters because you're familiar with their vernacular. And that this language has so many limitations that you can't fully even comprehend in just English what someone, I mean, language is so underestimated and story is overestimated that when you tell a story of a certain region that you, to some extent, I don't know if you agree, do justice to it because you understand like phrases or things that people would be thinking or the language that they think in. And for that, thank you. That's all I have to say.
Thank you. Thank you. You're very kind. Thank you.
Gentleman back there. G will come to you.
Sir, please teach us how to be happy.
How to be happy.
That's a comment.
Well, I, if you don't mind, yeah. I would
jaldi, love... Jaldi so jaya kare, raat.
Ko. नहीं उससे पहले एक शिक है कि पहले आप पढ़ें लेडी ऑफ एलिस भट्टी और उसके बाद आप जल्दी सो जाएं.
नो नो माय क्वेश्चन रिमेंस सर यू आर वेल ट्रेवल्ड. Do they still make guillotines in France? I need 24 of them from Islamabad city.
That young lady, and that's the last question, please.
Thank you. Sir, I really feel honored that I'm able to ask you this question today. The first time I had read about your biography, if I can say it like that, after reading your writings on BBC Urdu for a long time, and I'm truly, truly fascinated by that, as much as I'm fascinated by your English writings. I was deeply fascinated to read that you did a course of creative writing from England.
Yes.
And, you know, people like me who go to the public schools in Pakistan, you know, it made me fascinate about the British education academic institutions for months. And for me, it was kind of a surprise that there are institutions like this in some countries where you can actually just go and take up a course like creative writing and learn how to do it. And of course, I could never imagine it in Pakistan, especially the government schools that I went to. Now, today, when I've entered my professional life, I know that there are organizations that provide such courses, such trainings, and if you are able to pay their big fees, then you can have access to that. But sir, people like you, who are so popular, and who, I mean, people like me, we have a great inspiration, you know, when we read your writings. Don't you think that that there should be some kind of a initiative that should be taken by writers like you, because you have access to common people?
हम करते रहते हैं. This is like going to a cave, writing courses like what you used to have here. के कुछ writers हैं, हर हफ्ते मिलते हैं, हल्का यार बाबिस ऑफ type. के उसमें पढ़ते हैं लोग चीजें लिखते हैं उसके बाद. तो we kind of done in Karachi, but the nature of these things is कि आपका एक group होता है, you kind of start. Kind of everybody kind of writes and then
sir,
shares.
Sir, Islamabad mein bhi aake is tarah kai thakar Babes Oak bana liye kare. Where people like me could come. Because there's a lot that I think I can learn from you, and there's a lot that I really, many people like me would like.
Bilkul, jab aap kahein, mera jo aakhri ko kar rahe the hum Karachi mein, aise, it's like informal, like, you know, twice a month type meeting. But aam taur pe uski umar jo hai badi choti hoti hai, kyunki deir do saal ke baad, किसी का किसी के साथ चक्कर शुरू हो जाता है. एवरीबडी एल्स स्टार्ट्स हेटिंग देम कि उसके साथ कमेंट्री भी हो सकती है. सो वी हैव हैड लाइक वन नॉवल आउट ऑफ दैट ग्रुप एंड आई थिंक दो शादियां हो चुकी हैं उसमें.
लेकिन सर एक नॉवल तो लिखा गया.
व्हिच इज काइंड ऑफ या प्रोडक्टिव आई गेस.
आई एम सॉरी वी गॉट दिस वन पर्सन हु हैज बीन लास्ट क्वेश्चन जी. इसके बाद वी कैन नॉट.
Response from the powers that be, or the people whom it has been named for your political work.
Powers that be, con hai. Why don't you name them?
The ISI, the MI, the NIA, the GHQ, the ISPR.
Nahi. Mujhe abhi Liberty Books ke ek bache ne bataya ki wo aaye the. Unhone bada daanta, to maine kaha tumne kya kiya? Usne kaha humne hata di. Wo chale gaye. Do din ke baad humne phir rakh di. Powers that be को भी आपको पता है लोग लाहौर इस्लामाबाद में बहुत ज्यादा सीरियसली नहीं लेते. बट अगर आप बलोचिस्तान में हो तो वो powers that be जो है वो बहुत बड़ी बन जाती है. आपके इस्लामाबाद में वो शायद इतनी बड़ी.
थैंक यू वेरी मच लेडीज एंड जेंटलमैन. आई एम सो सॉरी.
थैंक यू सो मच. थैंक यू.
Ladies and gentlemen, there's a brief announcement. Book signing by Mohammad Hanif will be held outside in the corridor. So if you're interested in getting your book signed, you can do so. So we'll just break for the lunch right now, and shall be back at 2:45.